morning and welcome to Clayton Valley Presbyterian Church. It is wonderful to have you here this morning to worship with us. Good morning and welcome to Clayton Valley Presbyterian Church on this, the 16th of May. In announcements, first of all, I am going to be taking the month of August off, and I would like to extend the opportunity, if any of you would be interested in preaching, to approach me and let me know. You all are, as in the back of our bulletin, the ministers are all the people. So if any of you has a word that you would like to share, now is your opportunity. So let me know if you'd be interested in doing that. Second of all, as you know, Michelle, our Children's Center Director, is retiring. Her last date will be June 11th, and we are throwing a party for her on Sunday, June 27th after church. Actually, it's noon, so you have a little bit of a time between church and to show up or to come out or to just adjust from service. It will be a barbecue, and you are all invited to bring a salad to share. Also, we are taking up a love offering ahead of time that we would like to be able to present to her on that day. So please send any money towards a love offering for Michelle to the church. Put her name on the memo, and we will give it to her at the barbecue. Next week is Pentecost, so don't forget to wear red and come prepared to celebrate the birthday of the church with a party. We still need folks to sign up to be greeters and for flowers, and as you know, the rest of church activities continue. This is the day that our God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Hi, George Anich here for our Mission and Peacemaking Committee, and I'm here today to talk briefly about volunteering. One of the very difficult things about coming through this pandemic is that we want to help people, but we're not able to in a hands-on way as far as missions, or sometimes even in an eyes-on way. So what do we do now? Is it safe? Is the pandemic over? Are we ready to volunteer? Of course, the answer is up to each individual, but on the Mission Committee, we have looked at some volunteer opportunities that are available now through agencies that we have long sponsored and trusted. For instance, Food Bank of Contra Costa County has some volunteer positions for food sorting and distribution. Monument Crisis Center is always going. There's food distribution administrative assistance volunteer positions open. Hope Solutions, which provides subsidized housing, has a virtual summer program and a backpack drive starting up soon. Winter Nights, which we've been a part of, is now planning for the next season. They house people temporarily in shelters and provide food in the county in different locations. Loaves and Fishes, some of you have been a part of, and that continues, as well as Project Linus, which is for making and distributing blankets for children. So please contact me or Dave Williams or other members of our mission committee, and we can point you in the right direction as far as volunteering these days, and you can donate your time, you can always donate your money, and please donate your prayers. Thank you.
The call to worship. Our Lord was a Lord who turned things upside down and inside out. A man who dined with sinners. A man who befriended prostitutes and tax collectors. A man who was called a heretic. A man who broke the Sabbath rules. A man who changed water into wine. And he bids us to follow him, to turn things upside down and inside out, to go where the hurting is, to change water into wine, to change who we are into the kingdom of God.
Easter day with joy was bright, the sun shone out with fairer light, when to their longing eyes restored, the apostles saw their risen Lord. He bade them see his hands, his side, where yet the glorious wounds abide, the tongue true, each made it plain, their Lord indeed was risen again. From every weapon death can wield, your own redeemed forever shield, O Lord of all, with us abide in this our joyful Easter time.
The celebration of God's grace. God loves us more than we can fathom. And so every sentence begins with God's call to us. Every act of faith begins as an act of grace extended first from God. Every breath of life begins as an invitation into life from the God who loves us into being. This is something we can count on. Thanks be to God. Amen. The prayer confessing our need for God's grace. It is then from that place of knowing your amazing grace that we turn to you, O God. God of abiding love, you choose us as your people and call us friends. Take our fragmented hearts, asking them to love, making whole our joy, our life reborn in you. Through Jesus Christ, who died because of human sin, amen. And this we know, before we even ask, it has been done, amen.
Joy, Christ is risen, alleluia.
These are the prayers that have come in this week. For Sharon McCready's granddaughter, Kelly, who is really needing some help right now, and also for her mother, Sharon's daughter, Jennifer, in dealing with those circumstances. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. Also for Sharon's stepdaughter in Virginia, who's having trouble coping with transitions in her life. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. Prayers for Jay Davis, a friend of the Gremmers whose mother died suddenly. Jay is really struggling and has also asked for prayers for her mother, the one who passed. Jay is needing guidance and a reason to go on. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. For George, who is the father of Dale and Diane's daughter-in-law, for a good recovery from surgery. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. Prayers of joy also for a new grandniece for Dale and Diane, Addison, who was born Friday to Amanda and Peter Scoville. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. For Bill Baird and his husband, John. John is hospitalized in the final stages of dementia and ALS. Prayers for strength and peace. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. And prayers for Barb's cousin, Jerry's family, since Jerry passed away the night of the 10th. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. On this, the last Sunday of Easter, we also lift up joys for a season well spent in reflections on resurrection and new life and God's presence with us. For beautiful spring days, for a slight cooling of the weather, for the flowers that are in bloom, and the community that is growing back together. For all of these thanksgivings, we lift them up in prayer. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. I invite you into a minute of silent reflection, and then we'll pray together. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we do come before you with joy at things returning, celebration for some steps back into normalcy, for the opportunities to reflect on a year that's been different, and to see the gifts that we have with eyes of filled with gratitude rather than taking everything that we have for granted. We give you thanks for that opportunity and that vision. We also come before you as a people who know that many are still grieving, and that we are called to be your hands and feet in the world, to help those who are experiencing loss and are experiencing sadness to find their way. Help us to be your strength in this world. Help us to be brave in standing up for what is right. Help us to walk with compassion and grace. For we pray all of these things using the prayer that your Son taught us.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's Old Testament reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 68 to 79. Bless the Lord God of Israel, because he has come to help and has delivered his people. He has raised up a mighty Savior for us in his servant David's house. Just as he said through the mouths of his holy prophets long ago. He has brought salvation from our enemies and from the power of all those who hate us. He has shown the mercy promised to our ancestors and remembered his holy covenant. The solemn pledge he made to our ancestor Abraham. He has granted that we would be rescued from the power of our enemies, so that we could serve him without fear. In holiness and righteousness in God's eyes, for as long as we live. You, child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way. You will tell his people how to be saved through the forgiveness of their sins. Because of our God's deep compassion, the dawn from heaven will break upon us to give light to those who are sitting in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide us on the path of peace.
Today we begin the book of Galatians, a study of the book of Galatians, and we are starting with Galatians 3, verse 1 to 9 and 23 through 29. Listen for God's word for you this morning. You irrational Galatians, who put a spell on you? Jesus Christ was put on display as crucified before your eyes. I just want to know this from you. Did you receive the Spirit by doing the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Are you so irrational? After you started with the Spirit, are you now finishing up with your own human effort? Did you experience so much for nothing? I wonder if it really was for nothing. So does the one providing you with the Spirit and working miracles among you do this by you doing the works of the law or by you believing what you heard? Understand that in the same way that Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness, those who believe are the children of Abraham. But when it saw ahead of time that God would make the Gentiles righteous on the basis of faith, Scripture preached the gospel in advance to Abraham, all the Gentiles will be blessed in you. Therefore, those who believe are blessed together with Abraham who believed. And then jumping to verse 23. Before faith came, we were guarded under the law, locked up until faith that was coming would be revealed, so that the law became our custodian until Christ, so that we might be made righteous by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a custodian. You are all God's children through faith in Christ Jesus. All of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free, nor is there male or female. For you are all one in Christ. Now, if you are Christ's, then indeed you are Abraham's descendants, heirs according to the promise. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So today we continue our, actually, last week we started our exploration of the book of Galatians, and we continue today, and we hear more about this conflict that was going on in the early church. All through the book of Acts, we were learning about this conflict in the early church, and now we're in the book of Galatians, and we're still hearing about these conflicts in the early church as they tried to understand who they were and where they are. But today's conflict has to do with how one receives the Spirit. How one receives the Spirit. I'm repeating myself, but how one makes or creates or invites the Holy Spirit to come into their life. And what's the answer to that? Well, how did your new life start? Paul asks. And again, we get the same answer that we've been getting all along, which is, you didn't do it. You did not create this. And Paul is really angry at this point. I love some of the different translations. The Message version says, did someone put a spell on you? Have you taken leave of your senses? It's obvious that you no longer have the crucified Christ in clear focus in your lives. The Common English translation, which I read to you this morning, is, you irrational Galatians, who put a spell on you? And the NIV translates it, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Okay, whichever of these translations you prefer, it's really clear Paul is mad, right? And he's yelling, he's angry, he's really upset because they're still fighting about what they need to do to get the Spirit to come to them. They're still fighting about this. And he's like, you were there. And you saw that all of this stuff happened with you doing nothing. You didn't create the resurrection. You didn't bring Jesus here to be with us and show us who God was. You didn't do any of this. And yet you're still fighting about what you need to do. The Holy Spirit descended at Pentecost, which we'll celebrate next week. And you didn't create that. You didn't make that happen. And yet you guys are still fighting over this. So he's a little outraged. He's a little mad. He said that people are being foolish. They're being foolish because they have forgotten that they really have nothing to do with it. They can't make grace happen. They can't make the Spirit come. They are not capable of forcing God's presence. They can't do that. They can't control it. God is a wild lion, as C.S. Lewis would say, not a tame lion, and we don't get to be in charge of that. But that was hard then, and frankly, it's hard now. It's hard now. I had a friend in my lectionary group who was, as we were discussing this passage, was talking about how she and a friend of hers went to a Pentecostal church when they were children to watch the baptism of a friend of theirs. And what was interesting was that after they baptized the baby, and I don't know if this is standard, so if it's not, I apologize to the Pentecostals who might be listening to the service, not likely, but apologize to them anyway. But regardless, in this particular instance, what they do a full immersion baptism, and then you wait, and you are required to wait with the person who's been baptized, or in this situation, where it's required to wait until they started speaking in tongues, because that was the sign that the Holy Spirit had descended, and so they were just going to wait, and it could be 30 seconds or it could be 5 hours that they would all be praying frantically for the Holy Spirit to descend, and they would not recognize the Spirit as having descended until the person who had been baptized had just been speaking in tongues. So this is not quite the same as trying to, force salvation. But it is saying, we lined up everything, and so now, Holy Spirit, it's your job to show up, okay? We put it all together, and so, Holy Spirit, and not only do you have to show up because we've done it all right, we've baptized, we've done all these steps, and so now, Holy Spirit, you got to come, but you got to come in a very specific way, and that specific way is going to look like speaking in tongues. Yeah. Okay, we can't do that. We can't control it. That's not our job, and as Paul says, it's not about us. But the truth is, we struggle with this too. And I think part of it part of the way in which we struggle with it is we have a hard time accepting what we call, and I keep hearing this phrase, cheap grace. And what people mean by cheap grace is grace that you didn't somehow earn. We want to believe that the good things that we have in our life and our connection with God and our connection with each other and all of that is something that we created, that we did to deserve it. We have a really hard time remembering that grace, by the very word grace, is a gift freely given. There is nothing we can do. We cannot force the Holy Spirit to come down on us. We hear in this story, but in other stories, that the Spirit becomes most manifest, frankly, when people take the time to listen. Because, again, God's grace is abundant, and the Spirit is all around us. So if there's anything we have to do, it's to listen and to be present. As the scripture we read from Acts 15 a couple of weeks back said, once Peter spoke, the whole assembly fell silent. That silence, that breathing in, is an invitation for the Spirit to be manifest and to come and to be with us. It's through listening. And different denominations take this seriously in different ways. I think about Quakers, and their whole service is one of listening. They gather together in silence, and they listen for what the Spirit has to say to them in community with each other, but in silence. And then if they feel moved to speak, they can share that, but much of the time it remains in silence. Presbyterians don't tend to spend as much time in silence, so now that we have Taizé services, we're working on that, we're moving in that direction. But we still believe that Spirit is discerned or recognized or shows up most of the time in community. We recognize that while Spirit can touch a person personally, it is not private. It is not a private thing. Spirit comes in community and manifests in community. It's for this reason that we believe, Presbyterians believe very, very strongly in that call is discerned in community. But it's more than that. The reason we have a session that leads us rather than a bishop is because a session creates that community whose job is to pray and to listen for the Holy Spirit. Then we move to the next larger body, which is the presbytery. And the same thing. This week we had presbytery, went very late. But there was 200 people. We're all on a Zoom call, but we're all listening for the Spirit. We're listening, even, in a part, but together through Zoom. We are listening for the manifestation of the Spirit. But it also... it's not, again, while it can still be personal, and that's what I want to say, it can still be personal, but it's still discerned in community. So, for example, we deeply believe, Presbyterians, that call to being a pastor, but frankly, any call, is discerned by community, not just individuals. Reminds me of a situation in Ohio that just always comes to mind when I think about this, the importance of our belief that the Holy Spirit comes in community and is manifest in community as community discerns. I think about this situation that we had in the presbytery in Ohio. So as you know, when a person wants to be a pastor, they go through all sorts of stuff. It's not just 4 years of school and then you're ordained. Because we believe call is discerned in community, first a congregation has to say, yes, we agree this person is called. And then that person has to take exams and spend 3 years with a committee at the presbytery level who is also working to discern whether that person is called into ministry. It is not a small process. It's not a short process. It's not an easy process because we take it very seriously. Well, when I was at this presbytery meeting, there was a pastor there who had insisted on going to a non-Presbyterian seminary. And the presbytery said to him, okay, we're going to honor your decision to do that, but we require you to take a number of classes at the nearby Presbyterian seminary as well. If you want to be a Presbyterian minister, you need to take these classes at a Presbyterian seminary as well. Well, he was outraged. He was outraged, and he kept saying, and I didn't do it, and I am still a Presbyterian minister. I just didn't do what they said because my call was not to do that. And the rest of us were just like, and you obviously missed it because you did not come to understand that call is discerned in community, which is part of why we wanted you to go to a Presbyterian seminary, so that you would come to this understanding. Interestingly enough, the man ended up leaving the Presbyterian denomination about 3 years later. Again, he hadn't discerned with the community, had not trusted that the Spirit talked through the body. He had not trusted that the Spirit talks in community. So he'd gone his own way, done his own thing, and in the end, ended up taking himself out of the church completely. The thing is that Spirit language can be used manipulatively, as we know. God said to me, blah, 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 blah. The Spirit has revealed to me, blah, blah, blah. And people use this to then state things that they believe or that they hold dear. You know, God told me. God told me I was chosen for this. God told me that, you know, we need to exclude those people over there, whatever it is, okay? And that is also a big part of the reason why Presbyterians do not trust that the Spirit is accurately discerned without the validation and the confirmation of community. Because we get confused. There's a lot of voices coming at us. And it's easy for us to, when we feel righteous about something, to claim, well, it's because God told me. And instead, we need to trust that how we discern, whether that's just our own perverseness, our own confusion, or whether it really is the speaking of the Spirit, is to check it out in community. It helps us to stay accountable. The Holy Spirit is not for personality cult. Again, it can touch us personally, but it is never a private thing. It is never a private thing. It's all about community. It's all about serving each other. It's all about connecting with each other. It's all about loving your neighbor as yourself. And that has to be discerned in community. One of the other things that came up in our lectionary group as we were discussing this, it's 12 pastors that gather together. Again, every Tuesday morning we do this. Most of them are on the East Coast, so it's a very early morning for me, Tuesday mornings. But I really love this and value this. And we were talking about how for all of us, and it was unanimous, all of us have had the experience of preaching something, standing at the back, and having parishioners come out and say, thank you so much for saying X, and we just, our jaws drop open because we never said that. All of us have had this experience on numerous times, and most of the time, we just kind of go, oh, good, thank you. But, I remember, leaving, and sometimes it's just so different from what I feel like I've said. But I think that what this points out is that sometimes the Spirit moves among us in community, even despite us. And that people can hear what they need to hear when they are in a spirit of listening and in a spirit of prayer with other people. They can hear what they need to hear despite what's actually being said. They can hear, they can be touched by the Spirit despite themselves. Again, it can be personal in those moments, but it is not private. Barb George forwarded to me a YouTube video this week that I wanted to share with you, but since the lighting in here doesn't really allow me to do that, I thought I'd just tell you about it. The video is called Shoulder Taps, and in it, Bill Hart says this. Tony and I were having lunch at California Pizza Kitchen the other day, and I noticed this elderly woman who was dressed nicely sitting down at a large table by herself for about 5 minutes. And then after a while, her daughter and three or so grandkids showed up. And they're looking spectacular and like they're getting ready for a nice meal. About that time, a voice in my head said, "You should go and tell her how pretty she looks." our food arrived and the check arrived, and we're going on through our actions, and then we need to walk down this walkway in this strip center and onto the next thing that we're going to go on to. But on my way out, that call was persistent, and so I knelt down, put myself down at her level where she is in her chair, and I say, if no one else has told you this today, I just wanted to say how lovely you are. She looked at me with a look I'd never seen before, and she said, I know you. I said, no, we've never met each other. And she said, I know your spirit. And it gets really quiet between us, and she says, my husband died a year ago, and that is something he would have said to me. And at that moment, I can't talk. I'm overcome by emotion, and I just hug her, smile at her through tears, and I leave. But here is what I know and why I am telling you this. I believe the Spirit taps us on the shoulders and uses us at just the right moment. And what I know for sure is that she was blessed, and I was enormously blessed. So I've learned in my life to listen to those shoulder taps because they happen. And the more we listen to them, the more in alignment we are with God. And that is an awesome place to be. There are lots of moments when the Spirit reaches out and touches us, especially when we are in community, especially when we are with one another. But we will miss them if we are not listening. And so the silence and the time together and the worship time gives us a chance to listen. I was given a song a couple of months ago. A friend sent it to me that I think really speaks to this. And I'm going to play it for you at the end of this service. But right now, I just want to share with you the lyrics. It's called Speak Now from One Night in Miami. Listen. Listen while the storm in your heart is raging. Listen, listen, listen. Listen, listen to the echoes of martyrs praying. Listen, listen, listen. Listen, brothers and sisters, listen. I swear we'll never find a way to where we're going all alone. Don't take your eyes off the road. Can you hear the bells ring out? Speak now, speak now. Can you hear the angels sing loud? Speak now, speak now. Listen, listen to the message of hope in the whispers of ghosts. Listen, listen. Listen, for the children will grow on the seeds that we sow. They listen, they listen. Oh, listen, brothers and sisters, listen, I swear we'll never find a way to where we're going all alone. Don't hold your tongue. Can you hear the angels cry out? Speak now, speak now. Growth happens, change happens, and grace abounds. And that grace comes when we are able to listen. I want to share one more story with you about listening. One of my pastor friends, again, in Ohio, began a storefront church called the Phoenix Project that was to serve the really poor, down and out, extreme poverty, homeless, houseless, unsheltered people in Cleveland. And the people who came in ended up actually being young people. Teenagers and young adults, many of whom were struggling with addiction or rejection from their families because of their sexual orientation or gender identity, all of whom were poor, were homeless, were extremely in extreme painful, difficult, painful situations. And they came in, and she built this amazing church community. And the presbytery supported this for a while, But we have a basic guidance in our Presbyterian system that generally says if a faith community is not self-supporting within 5 years, then we, too bad for them. And unfortunately, this was a community that was never going to be self-supporting. You know, these are teenagers and young adults who are not making it. And so eventually, this program was shut down. And that was a time when I felt like the Presbytery was not listening to the Spirit. So even in community, we make mistakes. Even in community, we make mistakes. But that 5 years where they did exist made a huge difference in the lives of these people, of these young people. I recognized in this story that listening sometimes has to go more than one direction. And what I mean by that is that when someone has a vision or an idea, usually they have sat with it for, you know, a year, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years before they tell other people. And when they share that idea with other people, sometimes the first reaction is no. So like in this case, you know, going to the Presbytery and saying, you know, they're not actually going to be self-supportive. The Presbytery hadn't had the time that my pastor friend had with this community to think this through. And so it took them time to process that. That listening and that pain around change goes both ways. It takes people time. If you've had 20 years to sit with something, expecting other people to get it right away is not realistic. So we need to listen the other direction too. And when others are struggling to hear, or they're struggling to believe, or they're struggling to discern the winds of the Spirit as they blow, giving them time is an important gift that we can give, because it does take not just community, but time. The Spirit continues to move. We can't do anything to deserve that, which is where we started with this. We certainly can't do anything to force it. We can't make it come, but it is there, speaking. And our call is just simply to listen. So as we end this, I invite you to be in a spirit of prayer, and we are going to play that song for you to end the sermon. Thanks be to God.
Listen, listen, while the storm in your heart is raging. Listen, listen, listen. Listen, listen to the echoes of martyrs praying. Listen, listen, listen. Listen, brothers and sisters, listen, listen, listen. I swear we'll never find a way to where we're going. All alone, don't take your eyes off the road. Can you hear the bells ring out? Speak now, speak now. Can you hear the angels sing low? Speak now, speak now. The message of hope and the whispers of ghosts. Listen, listen. Listen, for the children will grow on the seeds that we sow. They listen, they listen. Oh, listen. Brothers and sisters, listen, listen. Where we'll never find a way to where we're going. All alone, don't take your ride. her, oh, 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 oh. Can you hear the bells ring out? Speak now. Can you hear the angels cry out? Speak now.
The Unison Prayer of Thanksgiving. In joy and gratitude, we come before you, offering back our gifts to you. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God. the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All thy works with joy surround the earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around this center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Mortals, join the happy chorus which the morning stars began. Love divine is reigning o'er us, joining all in heaven's plan. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of life.
I say to you, life is short. And while we have little time to grace the lives of those with whom we travel, the Spirit has an infinite amount of time to touch us, to move us, to move among us and through us. So I invite you to take the space to listen to one another, to listen in community, and mostly to just listen for the Spirit. For it is there speaking to you, calling you, guiding you in every moment. And may God, Creator Christ, and Holy Spirit be with you and bless you this day and forevermore. Amen.